Hey guys, what's up? So we have covered the first 200 MCQs here, and now let us discuss the remaining 800. And I know it is a long journey, but trust me, by the time you are done with this journey, you will know a lot about environment and ecology. Question number 201. Identify the national park using the following characteristics. It is the largest wildlife sanctuary in India. It is located in the Little Run of Kutch. So it has to be Indian Wildlife Sanctuary. So answer here becomes A. So Indian Wildlife Sanctuary, also known as the Wildlife Sanctuary, it is located in the Little Run of Kutch, which is a place in Gujarat, state of India. It is a coastal state bordering with Pakistan and Rajasthan, and obviously Maharashtra and other states. So it is spread over 5000 km square. It is the largest wildlife sanctuary in entire India. It was established in 1972, and the sanctuary is one of the last places on earth where the endangered wild ass subspecies, that is Indian wild ass khur, belonging to the Asiatic wild ass species onager, can be spotted. Okay, so try to remember these names, it will help you a lot. Question number 202. Which of the following are limiting factors for primary production for terrestrial ecosystem? So obviously all of these are very, very important. All of them can act as limiting factor, depends on the region. For example, in desert, you will find a lot of sunlight, a lot of temperature, but lack of rainfall. So there it becomes the limiting factor. For example, in a place where there is like a lot of cloud covers, then sunlight becomes the main bottleneck. So it depends from place to place. So here answer becomes basically D, 1, 2, 3. All of these statements are correct. So the rate of primary production by plants, it is determined largely by light, temperature and rainfall. And the favorable combination of intense sunlight for 12 hours per day, warm temperatures throughout the year, considerable rainfall, it make the tropical rainforest the most productive ecosystem on entire land. Question number 203. Consider the following statements. There is an upper limit to primary production. Obviously there is an upper limit to everything in life, including primary production. Ecological succession is a particular direction. Yes, it moves from pioneer species and transition species, and finally you'll have a climax species that basically is in equilibrium with their local environment. So answer here is C, both 1 and 2. Both these statements are absolutely correct. There is no doubt about it. So the upper limit of primary production is due to the fixed amount of sunlight available for plants, which implies that plants can only use a limited amount of sunlight. And plants do not use all of the light energy theoretically available to them. And if you reduce the cost of respiration, plants' net primary production is reduced to 0.05 to 0.06% of the solar constant. So this is considered the average efficiency, and in land plants this value can reach up to 2 to 3%. In aquatic system this can maximum to 1%. And ecological succession is obviously unidirectional, and with the community progressing from pioneer to climax communities, the last species which comes called as the climax species. Question number 204. Red data books deals with, so basically deals with those plants and animals which are on verge of extinction but are not extinct as of now. Answer is C. It is published by UCN. Okay, so Red Data Book is the most comprehensive inventory of the global conservation status of biological species. Red Data Book is the document established by IUCN for documenting rare and endangered species of animals, plants, fungus, as well as some local subspecies that exist within the territory of the state or the country. So answer is basically C. Question number 205. Which of the following has the lowest primary productivity? So if I have to pin down one, then it has to be Arctic tundra. So Arctic tundra has the lowest primary productivity. So it is exposed to reduced light intensity, very cold winter, cool summers, and primary productivity is very, very low here. And in the tropics, water, light, high temperature are readily available, and there is a dense concentration of green plants at all the levels, and hence they have a very, very high level of productivity. So answer here is A, basically Arctic tundra. Question number 206, assertion and reason question. Direct competition occurs when individuals compete with each other directly for the same resource. Yes, obviously this is correct. There is no doubt about it. Second statement is two bull moose battling for access to a single female. So basically answer is B, like there is no way that the reasons and assertion are correct, explanation of each other. So reason statement is basically an example of for the assertion statement. So answer is basically both A and R are true, but it is not the correct explanation. Question number 207. Which of the following are the reasons for global dimming? So increased presence of aerosol particles in the atmosphere because of human action. So that is correct. Reducing resources of sun resulting in reduced sunlight. So that is not correct. So answer is A, one only. So global dimming is basically decrease in the amount of solar radiation reaching the surface of the earth. And global dimming is due to the increased presence of aerosol particles in the atmosphere caused by human action. And basically they reflected back into the space. Okay. So the reduction of in energy of sun is very negligible and it cannot affect the solar insolation on a day-to-day basis. So the second statement is wrong. Then you have question number 208, again an assertion region type question. Secondary succession is much faster than primary succession. Obviously, yes. Because in secondary succession, what happens is the life existed some time ago, but it is no longer there. Since life already existed there, so it is much faster now than the primary succession. The reason is the soil is already formed but deteriorated in secondary succession. That is 100% correct. So both the assertion and reason are correct. And the reason is correct explanation of assertion. So both the assertion and reason are true and reason is the correct explanation of assertion. So secondary succession is a process started by an event, example forest fire, harvesting, hurricane, etc. that reduces an already established ecosystem, example a forest or a wheat field, to a smaller population of species. And as such, secondary succession occurs on pre-existing soil, whereas primary succession usually occurs in a place which lacks soil. And secondary succession is much faster than the primary succession because the soil is already formed, although deteriorated and needing restoration as well. Question number 209, the anthropogenic factors for loss of biodiversity are? So deforestation, yes, because of humans, we cut a lot of trees, so that is why it affects the biodiversity. Global warming is also there, yes, that is also correct. Environmental pollution is also there, yes, all of these occur because of human beings. So if you remove human beings from the earth will become normal. So answer here is D, all of the above. So anthropogenic factors are man-made or human-induced factors, and they include destruction of habitat, hunting and fishing, controlling predators, pests, introduction of exotic species, pollution, genetic assimilation. So by using such means, we are reducing the biodiversity of planet Earth, unfortunately. Question number 210, which of the following statement is or are correct? Ecosystems are not hierarchical. No, they are hierarchical structure. They are layered and they comprise a smaller ecosystem, like a forest ecosystem will comprise a smaller tree ecosystem, which in turn consists of smaller ones, etc. Ecosystem is a closed system. This is wrong. It is rather an open system because exchange can happen. So answer here becomes D, neither one nor two. Both these statements are wrong. They are hierarchical and they are open system because both matter and energy are exchanged between the system and its surrounding environment. Any ecosystem is always an open system. Thank you for watching this lesson. Hey guys, what's up? So let us discuss question number 211 to 220. And we have already covered the significant portion of environment and ecology, yet more than 79% is still left. So let's get started. Identify the national park using the following characteristics. Okay. It was India's first national park established in 1936 as Haley National Park. So you don't have to go further than this. India's first national park is Jim Corbett National Park. So answer is A, Jim Corbett. It was established to protect the endangered Bengal tiger. That is correct. So answer here is basically A, Jim Corbett National Park. Sorry for these options. Answer is Jim Corbett National Park. It is the oldest national park in India. It was established in 1936 as Haley National Park. It was done to protect the endangered Bengal tiger. It is located in the Nainital district of Uttaranchal or Uttarakhand. And it was named after Jim Corbett, who played a key role in its establishment. And the park was first to come under the Project Tiger initiative to save the tigers countrywide because of the dwindling population. Now finally their population is back on track. Biogas is a mixture of, so biogas is basically CH4 and CO2. So it is a mixture of methane and carbon dioxide. So answer here becomes A. So methane and carbon dioxide. So biogas typically refers to a mixture of different gases produced by the breakdown of organic matter in the absence of oxygen. Biogas is primarily methane, CH4 and carbon dioxide, CO2. And it may even have small amounts of hydrogen sulfide, that is H2S. And biogas basically can be produced through biogas plants or gobar gas plant. They can be produced from raw material like agricultural waste, manure, municipal waste, plant material, sewage, green waste, food waste, etc. Any of this can be used to produce.
lots of biogas, especially it is true for the rural economy because their electricity issues are there in India. Most primary production in an open ocean occurs near the surface. Yes, because sunlight does not penetrate to the deep part and sunlight only penetrates to a certain region. The sunlight cannot penetrate great depths. No, sunlight can penetrate to great depths, but this is wrong. It can penetrate to great depths, but the bilkul bottom pe nahi jata. But sunlight can penetrate, especially if you are talking about surface, then this statement is wrong. So answer here is assertion is true, but reason is false. Because surface is a lot of nutrients and like if you go deep down, this nutrients reduces. So all the primary production occurs near the surface as long as the nutrients are available. And although the waters of the open ocean, they are very clear and sunlight can penetrate to great depths, the scarcity of nutrients reduces the rate of primary production to less than 1/10 that of coastal bays. So it is the surface of ocean that is more productive than the actual depths. Question number 124, which of the following are the limiting factors of photosynthesis? See, let's assume there is no CO2. Can photosynthesis happen? Answer is no. Let's assume it is sub-zero temperature. Can photosynthesis happen? Very, very low. Let's assume there is no light. Can photosynthesis happen? Answer is no. So you need light intensity, temperature, CO2. All of this can become limiting factor. If it gets too cold, the rate of photosynthesis will decrease. If it gets too hot, the plants will die. And obviously CO2 is also needed. So answer is D, 1, 2, 3. So three factors can limit the speed of photosynthesis. They include light intensity, carbon dioxide, water. Without enough light, a plant cannot photosynthesize very quickly, even if there is plenty of water and CO2. And increasing the light intensity will boost the speed of photosynthesis. And an increase in the CO2 concentration increases the rate at which carbon is incorporated into carbohydrate in the light independent reaction, and so the rate of photosynthesis generally increases until limited by another factor. So if global warming happens, then photosynthesis will be much more than today because of lot of carbon dioxide being released in the atmosphere. If it gets too cold, the rate of photosynthesis will decrease again, and plants cannot photosynthesize if it gets too hot. So answer is D, 1, 2, 3. Question number 215, which of the following statement is or are correct? There is no difference between detritivorous and decomposers. No, there is a difference between them. Detritivores basically recycle the decomposing organic material. Decomposers break down the organic material from the decaying organism. So technically they are different. Both detritivorous and decomposers get nutrition from dead organic matter. This is correct. This is absolutely correct. So answer here becomes B, that is 2 only. So decomposers, they break down the organic material from the decaying organisms. And detritivorous recycle the decomposing organic material. Most of the decomposers are usually microscopic, like bacteria or fungus, whereas detritivorous, they come in different forms like worms, millipedes, wood lice, dung flies, slugs in the terrestrial aspect, while there are detritivorous which are present in the water as well. Okay, so do not worry about this. So answer is B, 2 only. Question number 216. So which of the following are the characteristics of a stable ecosystem? So there are a lot of characteristics of stable ecosystem. So let us see, dynamic equilibrium. Yes, definitely you should have a dynamic equilibrium. Maturity, yes. High energy, yes. High species diversity should be there for a stable ecosystem. This is wrong. So answer here becomes 1, 2, 3, that is B only. So they are in dynamic equilibrium. They are mature ecosystems. They have high inertia. So they have high species diversity. They have a diversity of food web as well. So answer here is basically B, 1, 2, 3. Question number 217, which of the following statement is or are correct? Solar radiation is the basic input of energy which enters the ecosystem. Yes, for most ecosystems on land, the pyramid of biomass has a large base of primary producers. Yes, herbivores constitute primary consumers. Yes, so answer here is D, all of the above. All these statements are absolutely correct. Question number 218, which of the following statement is or are correct? The functional role and position of a species in relation to other species in a given ecosystem, basically what they perform in an ecosystem, what is their role, what are they supposed to do, that is called as ecological niche. Okay, whether they are decomposer, whether they are primary consumer, whether they are tree dwellers, what they are. Second statement is the stability of ecosystem depends upon diversity of a niche. Yes, more the diverse the niche, more the diversity of the species, more complex is the food web, more complex is the food chain, more stable is the ecosystem. Answer here is C, both 1 and 2. So ecological niche is defined as the functional role and position of a species in an ecosystem. And ecosystem stability basically depends upon diversity of a niche. And greater the niche diversity, greater is the stability of the ecosystem. So answer is C, both 1 and 2. Question number 219. Consider the following statements regarding a climate type. The climate has highest concentration of winter rainfall. Okay. It is found in all the inhabited continents in the world. Now, if they are asking this, then it is Mediterranean climate, because it is talking about winter rainfall, it is talking about inhabited continents in the world, because it is found in California, it is found in Australia, it is found on the western side of the continents, it is found in the Mediterranean region, it is found in South Africa, Cape Town, it is found in the subtropics, and it is associated with shifting of global pressure belts. 100% Mediterranean type climate. So it is a fairly dry climate. Summers are dry, winters are wet and cool, and they occupy a limited area in the world, even though they are distributed over all the inhabited continents. Question number 220, which of the following principles must be followed in ecotourism? Minimize impact, yes. Build environmental and cultural awareness, yes. Provide financial benefits for conservation, yes. Answer is D, 1, 2, 3. So it also should empower local people and provide direct financial benefits for conservation and provide positive experience for both visitors and host. Thank you. Hey guys, what's up? So we are back with environment and ecology, and in this particular chapter lesson we will discuss question number 221 to 230. So let's get started. Which of the following is our gaseous cycle? So obviously sulfur, phosphorus, they can't be gaseous cycle, and these are sedimentary cycles. But carbon and nitrogen, since the carbon goes through the usually CO2 route and nitrogen obviously is a gas, so answer here is C, 3 and 4. Sulfur, phosphorus, they are basically rock based cycle. So biogeochemical cycles, so just listen to the term carefully, biogeochemical cycle. So there is a biological component involved, there is a geographical or geological component involved, there is a chemical component involved, and at the end of the day it's a cycle. So it has like a closed structure. It can be classified into gaseous, in which the reservoir is the air or the ocean, and sedimentary, in which the reservoir is earth's crust. So gaseous cycle includes those of nitrogen, oxygen, carbon and water, because here the reservoir is either air or ocean via evaporation. And sedimentary cycles include iron, calcium, phosphorus, sulfur and other more earthbound elements which are found in abundance in the crust. So gaseous cycle tend to move more rapidly because gas move more rapidly than the sedimentary ones, and to adjust more readily to changes in the biosphere because of the large atmospheric reservoir. So answer is C, 3 and 4. Question number 222, assertion, evergreen forests are mainly concentrated in the equatorial region. Yes, these regions receive very high rainfall. Yes, because they receive high rainfall, they are evergreen. Assertion is correct, and reason is the correct explanation of assertion. So equatorial hot wet climate is found between 5 to 10 degree north and south of the equator, and cloudiness, heavy precipitation, 150 to 250 centimeter of rainfall or more in a year helps to moderate the temperature, so that even at the equator climate is not unbearable, and there is no month without the rain, and a distinct dry season like that of savanna or tropical monsoon climate is absent here, and there is no season, basically every time it is the same, and the year round high temperature and abundant rainfall in equatorial region support a luxuriant type of vegetation which is called as tropical or equatorial rainforests. Question number 223, which of the following statement is or are correct? Biogas can be produced from raw materials such as agricultural waste, manure, municipal waste, plant material, sewage, green waste or food waste. Yes, anything can be used, any organic material can be used. Biogas is a renewable energy source. Yes, it is unlimited as long as the fresh waste material comes, which is again unlimited. So answer here becomes C, both 1 and 2. So biogas typically refers to a mixture of different gases produced by the breakdown of organic matter in the absence of oxygen, and it is a mixture of gases produced by the fermentation process of fresh waste material which is unlimited in anaerobic conditions, making biogas a renewable resource. So answer is C, both 1 and 2. Question number 224, primary succession takes longer duration to climax than secondary succession. Yes, correct. The absence of a soil seed bank and absence of soil impedes the establishment of vegetation during primary succession. Primary succession means succession of life where nothing exists at all. Secondary succession means where life existed earlier but now it is not there. In secondary succession, you have some semblance of soil, so it is easier for the life to grow there. So answer here is assertion and reason are true, and reason is the correct explanation of A, because primary succession takes longer because of absence of soil. So primary succession begins in barren areas such as on bare rock exposed by a retreating glacier where there was no life whatsoever. Soil is not immediately available in a primary succession and it must accumulate over time. It can be hundreds of years. First inhabitants are usually lichens or plants. Lichens is algae plus fungus, and those that can survive in such an environment. And over hundreds of years of these pioneer species are the species which come for the first time. They convert the rock into soil that can support simple plants such as grasses, etc. And presence of a well-stocked soil seed bank permits rapid development of species-rich ecosystem during the secondary succession. Question number 225. The thickness of the troposphere is greatest at the equator. That is correct. Near the equator, insolation is high and convection current is strong. Yes, the reason is correct explanation. So answer is A. So regions near the equator, they receive more sunlight than the poles, making them hotter and less air dense. And so equatorial gases reach very greater heights because warm air rises up to exert the same pressure as at the poles. So that is why it is thicker here. Question number 226. Which of the following statement is or are correct? Detritus food chain starts with green plants, which are the producer. This is wrong. It starts with dead organic material. Grazing food chain starts with dead organic matter. This is wrong. It starts with the producers, that is the green plants. So answer here is D, neither one nor two. The grazing food chain basically will start with grasses, which are like green plants, which are grazed by herbivorous animals. And detritus means which starts with dead organic matter, which is eaten by animals, which in turn are other animals in the soil, etc., etc. So answer is D, neither one nor two. Question number 227. At each trophic level, energy is lost in the form of basically heat. So light, so you do not emit light, right? So answer is A, heat. So the amount of energy at each trophic level decreases as it moves through an ecosystem. So it is called as 10% law of Lindemann. So that is correct here. So as little as 10% of the energy at any trophic level can go, and 90% is lost for sure. And the rest is lost largely through metabolic processes such as heat, etc. Question number 228. The detritus food chain, as it is called, begins from which of the following organism? So here it can begin from bacteria. So answer is C. So bacteria is basically a decomposer here, and hence a detritivore food chain can begin with the bacteria. And algae, plankton, they are producers, and hence they can convert sunlight into food. Viruses are basically obligate parasites, that is, they lack the metabolic machinery, they can't synthesize anything on their own. They are basically, they have to, obligate means necessary, okay, of their own. They can't generate on their own, they can't synthesize their own proteins, so they are dependent on host cells like anything. So that is why they can't, they are considered living or dead or the border of it. Question number 229. If decomposers are removed from an ecosystem, then the functional efficiency is affected because the nutrient flow or the cycle is affected. So answer here is C. So if decomposers are removed from an ecosystem, there will be no recycling of nutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur, etc., as the decomposers are responsible for most of the recycling, which basically converts dead material into forms that can be reused. So answer here is C. Okay, so just make sure that decomposers are as important as any other. Otherwise, you will find dead bodies lying around all over the place of animals, and nothing is happening to it. Question number 230. Which of the following is are part of the Ramsar sites in India? Loktak Lake, yes, definitely. Chilika Lake, yes. Vitarkanika mangroves, yes. They are all included in the Ramsar sites. Currently, it is 26. So answer is D, 1, 2, 3. So wetlands of international importance, they are also called as Ramsar sites because of the Ramsar Convention. It is a city in Iran. Total number of Ramsar wetland sites in India is 26. They include Bular Lake, Chilika Lake, Loktak Lake, Harike Lake, Kevala Dev National Park, etc. Thank you. Hey guys, what's up? So we are continue discussing the environment and ecology MCQs, and we are here covering question number 231 to 240. So let's get started. And it is very, very important that you understand these MCQs and you learn from them. And the MCQ per se is not important, it is the explanation that is more important. Question number 231. Identify the wildlife sanctuary using the following characteristics.
It is a riverine sanctuary situated at the tri point of Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh. It has to be Chambal, okay? Because that is the answer. So answer is A, and Ghadiyal is again in Chambal. And nesting of Indian skimmers is recorded in large numbers, so that is also correct. So answer here is National Chambal Sanctuary. So National Chambal Sanctuary is a tri-state sanctuary, and it lies in three states, that is Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and UP. So it is an area of 600 square kilometer in UP, spread over Agra and Etah districts, and also lies in Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan. And National Chambal Sanctuary is basically the main area for the species reintroduction program of the crocodilian species, that is Gavialis gangeticus, that is the Ghadiyal. And Chambal supports 8 rare turtle species out of the 26 which are found in the country. So you can realize the importance, like apart from Pansing Tomar, important species are also present here. And one of the few places to spot the Platanista gangetica, that is the gangetic dolphins. Question number 232, which of the following is considered as a minor forest produce? Okay, so ivory is definitely considered a minor, but timber is not considered. Yeah, timber to major hota hai. Honey, medicinal plants, all these are considered minor forest produce, which the tribals basically they can use for themselves, but not timber. So minor forest produce includes all the non-timber forest produce of plants, including bamboo, brushwood, stumps, canes, tussar, cocoon, honey, wax, lac, ivory, tendu, leaves, medicinal plants, herbs, roots, tuber, except the timber. Everything else is included here. Question number 233. Deserts have low primary production despite having favorable amount of light and temperature. This is correct. The lack of water in deserts severely limits the primary production. Yes, this is correct. So answer here is A, that both the assertion and reason are true. Reason is the correct explanation of assertion. So answer here becomes A. So net primary production is the amount of energy left over after autotrophs have met their own energetic needs and like respiration, etc. Terrestrial primary production is generally limited by temperature, moisture, etc. And in deserts, the lack of water severely limits primary production, even though light and temperature are otherwise favorable. So that is why it does not happen. Because water is not there. And aquatic primary production, because water does not have that much nutrients as compared to soil, so that is why it is limited. So answer here is all of this, like assertion and reason are true, and reason is the correct explanation of assertion. Question number 234. Which of the following statement is or are correct? Grazing chain starts with primary consumer at the first trophic level. Why will primary consumer be there? Producer will be there, right? So this is wrong. Detritus food chain starts with detritivorous oris or decomposer at the first trophic level. So this statement is correct. So answer here becomes B, that is 2 only. So trophic levels are the feeding positions of all organisms in a specific ecosystem. The first trophic level or base of an ecosystem has the highest energy concentration, and it contains the producers, green plants, etc. And grazing chain basically starts with producers and not primary consumers at the first trophic level. On the other hand, detritus food chain starts with detritivorous or decomposers at the first trophic level, and primary source of energy is basically dead organic matter, which is called as detritus, which are fallen leaves, plant parts, dead animal bodies, etc., etc. Question number 235. Consider the following statements. Which of the following are found in the Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve? So rhinos are found only in Northeast India, so this is definitely wrong. Nilgiri is in South India. Elephant is definitely found there. Tigers are there. Lion-tailed macaque is there. So answer here is C, 234. So Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve, it consists of elephant, tiger, gaur, sambar, lion-tailed macaque, cheetal, etc. And rhinos are found only in the Northeast India. So this statement is wrong. So answer here becomes 234. Question number 236. Which of the following statements about sholas is or are true? So sholas are the tropical montane forest of the southern India. Yes, this statement is correct. So that statement itself is correct. So they are the tropical montane forest of southern India. So answer here is A. So sholas are a local name for patches of stunted tropical montane forest, which are found in valleys amid rolling grasslands in the higher mountain regions of India. and the southern mountain forest, they include Western Ghats, Vindhyas, Nilgiris, etc. So answer here is A. Question number 237. Which of the following statements about eastern hills is or are true? So at the Dihang Gorge, the Himalayas take a sudden southward bend and they form a series of comparatively low hills. So this statement is correct. The famous Valley of Flowers is situated in this region. No, this is wrong. So answer here is A, that is one only. So Valley of Flowers National Park, it is located in the western Himalayas in the state of Uttarakhand, and it is known for its meadows of endemic alpine flowers, variety of flora, etc. So Valley of Flowers is in Uttarakhand. So, and this is, we are talking about eastern hills. So this statement is wrong. Question number 238. Which of the following is are the local techniques of water conservation? Madaks are used in Karnataka, Pemghara are used in Odisha, Johards are used in Rajasthan, my state. So answer here is D, 1, 2, 3. So all of these are basically local techniques of water conservation. You also have Bawdis, etc. in Rajasthan. So Madaks in Karnataka, Pemghad in Odisha, and Johards in Rajasthan. They are one of the oldest systems used to conserve and recharge the groundwater. And they are constructed on an area with a naturally high elevation on three sides. And soil is excavated to create a storage area. And it is used to create a wall on fourth side to the hold the water. Now they collect monsoon water, which slowly seeps into the to recharge the groundwater and maintain the soil moisture. And many johards are interconnected with a gully or deep channels with a single outlet in a river or stream to prevent structural damage. Question number 239. Which of the following statements about forest fires are correct? Forest fires in India usually peak during the dry months of December and January. This is wrong. So absolutely wrong statement. And you will find usually in dry period, okay, during summer. And as a natural process, they help forest by promoting flowering and seedling establishment. This is correct. So instead of the winters, so they happen during the summer when there is no rainfall. Forest becomes littered with dry leaves and twigs, and they can burst into flames ignited by the slightest spark. So answer here is B, 2 only. Question number 240. Diurnal cheetahs and nocturnal leopards using the same waterhole in a grassland savanna is an example of competition. Yes, this is correct. Indirect competition occurs when organisms use the same resource but don't necessarily interact with each other. Yes, this is correct, but it is not the explanation of the first. So because it is interspecific competition, it is a form of competition in which individuals of different species compete for the same resources in ecosystem. So this is an example of interspecific competition. So thank you for watching this lesson. Hey guys, what's up? So finally we are covering the 25% of this course, and we are here and we are covering the first 250 MCQs. I hope you really enjoyed this course. I did making this course, and we are here at the 25% marks. Makes me nostalgic. I've been working and I've been recording this course for almost now 1 month. So let us get started with question number 241 to 250. Question number 241. Which of the following conditions are suitable for the formation of the dew? So cloudy sky is definitely not suitable, not at all. Okay, dew formation occurs when the sky is clear. Cold and long nights, yes. Calm air, yes. High relative humidity is also yes. So the first statement is wrong. Since first is wrong, so answer can only be A or D. And cold and long nights would definitely help in the formation of dew. So answer here is basically D, 2, 3, 4. So the dew formation is more when the sky is clear and less when it is very, very cloudy. Now cold and long nights, calm air, high relative humidity, all of this help in the formation of dew. So answer here is basically 2, 3 and 4. Question number 242. Which of the following statement about desert ecosystem is or are correct? Desert, basically Registan, Thar Desert, Sahara Desert, even your Gobi Desert, Ladakh Desert. Most of the hot deserts, they lie between 15 and 30 degree parallel of latitude in both the hemispheres. Absolutely correct. They lie in the western parts of the continents where trade winds are offshore. This is also correct. For example, Sahara. For example, Thar. For example, Kalahari. For example, Namib. They are under the influence of basically cold ocean currents. Yes, this is also correct. So answer here is D. That is 1, 2, 3. All of these statements are apt for the desert ecosystem. And all of this will cover most of the deserts. Obviously, there are exceptions. So answer is all the statements are correct about the location of the deserts. Question number 243. Consider the following statements. Carbon dioxide is the most abundant gas after nitrogen and oxygen. This is absolutely wrong. Nitrogen is 78%, carbon dioxide is 21%, but argon is 0.9%, almost 1% is argon, okay, in the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide is just 0.038%. So this is wrong. Higher composition of dust particles is found in the subtropical regions when compared to the tropical regions. So that is correct. So answer here is basically B, that is 2 only. So argon is the most abundant gas after nitrogen and oxygen. Argon is 0.93% while carbon dioxide is just 0.038%. And the higher concentration of dust particles is found in the subtropical and temperate regions due to the dry winds in comparison to equatorial, polar regions, etc. So answer here is basically B, that is 2 only. First statement is absolutely wrong. Question number 244. Which of the following vary with the varying temperature? Humidity will definitely vary because warm air can hold more water. Okay. Cloud formation. Yes. Cloud formation depends on the dew point temperature. Precipitation. Yes. So it depends upon the amount of water vapor in the atmosphere. And if the temperature is higher, more is the water vapor and more is the chance of heavy showers. Answer is D, 1, 2, 3. So humidity changes when the temperature changes. Because warm air, obviously it can hold more water vapor than the cool air. So relative humidity will fall when the temperature will rise. So relative humidity is inversely proportional to the temperature. And if basharte there is no moisture added to the air. Now cloud formation depends on the dew point temperature. And if the air temperature is lower than the dew point temperature, cloud will form. But if the air temperature is higher than the dew point temperature, no cloud will form. Now, volume of rain that falls in a heavy shower depends on the amount of water vapor in the atmosphere. At higher temperatures, atmosphere may contain more water vapor and thus it increases the chance of heavy showers. So, answer here is basically D, that is 1, 2, 3. Question number 245, the effectiveness of any greenhouse gas basically depends on, so magnitude of its concentration, more the concentration of the gas, effectiveness also increases. Lifetime in atmosphere, yes, gases like CFCs, they can last for 100 years. Wavelength of radiation it absorbs, that is also correct. Answer is technically D, all of the above. All these statements are correct about the effectiveness of greenhouse gases. So each gas effect on climate change depends on three main factors: concentration or abundance, lifetime in the atmosphere, and wavelength of radiation it absorbs. So how much the gas can absorb specific wavelength of energy. An effective absorber of infrared radiation has a broader absorption profile, which means that it can absorb a wider spectrum of wavelengths and thus it can lead to more greenhouse. Question number 246. Which of the following are the effects of ocean currents? So arid areas in the west coast of the continents in the tropical and subtropical latitudes. Yes. Narrow annual range of temperature in mid and high latitude on the western coast. Yes. Obviously, they do replenish the oxygen and they help in the growth of planktons. That is also correct. Since 1 and 2 are correct, so obviously 3rd has to be correct, right? Because there is no option of 1 and 2 only. It is either A, B, C individually or D. So if 1 and 2 are 100% correct, then the only option that is left is D. You don't even have to look at C. So west coast of the continent in tropical and subtropical latitudes are bordered by the cool waters. And their average temperatures are relatively low with narrow diurnal and annual ranges. And generally, the areas are very arid. Now, west coast of the continents in the middle and higher latitudes, they are bordered by warm waters and hence they have a narrow annual range of temperatures and mixing of warm and cold currents, they help to replenish the oxygen and it also favor the growth of the planktons itself. Question number 247, consider the following statements about rainfall in equatorial region. Large scale evaporation and convectional air currents result in convectional rainfall. Yes, this is correct. Rain is well distributed throughout the year and there is no dry season or month. This is also correct. Answer is C, both 1 and 2. So it is uniformly high temperature throughout the year, uniform adequate rainfall throughout the year, and they are received through the convection. And most of the rainfall occurs through convection. Okay. But wherever mountain barrier becomes effective, the amount of rainfall obviously increases. So that was about the equatorial region. Question number 248. In a survey, it has been found that there are 6 herbivores in a particular ecosystem. What will be the total number of trophic levels in this ecosystem?
you cannot determine. It's absolutely ridiculous. There is no way you can determine 6 ho cha 16 ho cha 6 ho. It depends on what ecosystem you're talking about, how many predators you have, how many primary consumer, secondary consumer and tertiary consumer you have. That depends on that, okay? So number of organism, it cannot be determined by the number of, like number of organisms in a trophic level cannot determine the number of trophic. This is trophic, sorry for this, this is PHIC, okay? Question number 249, which of the following are considered as decomposer or detritivore? Virus is not there, absolutely not there. It is in border of living and dead. Fungus and bacteria are definitely there. So answer here is C, that is 1 and 3. Decomposers are organisms that aid in the decomposition of already dead or dying organisms. And bacteria or fungi are some of the examples of decomposers. They get their energy from dead organisms. Apart from animal and plant waste products, virus is nothing. It's neither a decomposer nor a detritivore. Which of the following causes harmful algal blooms? Discharge of nutrients, yes. Warming water temperature, yes. Changes in salinity, yes. So answer is D, all of the above. So harmful algal blooms occurs when colonies of algae, they grow out of control and they produce a lot of toxic or harmful effects. It happens because of eutrophication, mainly of phosphorus, nitrogen and carbon. And it kills people, fish, shellfish, marine mammals, birds. So thank you for watching this lesson. Hey guys, what's up? So we are discussing very very important concept and I have already covered 25% of the course. I have covered the first 250 MCQs which will help you in become master of environment and ecology. So let's get started with our another 25% from 250 to 500. Try to like imagine yourself and like doing an interstellar journey. It is that hard, but sometimes you just have to like be a professional aspirant and just go through with it. So we'll discuss question number 251 to 260 in this particular lesson. So let's get started. Consider the following statements. Sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides. So yes, these are, this can cause acid rain. Methane, ozone, they do not cause any acid rain. So answer here is basically A, that is 1 and 2 only. Okay, so sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, these are the only gases that can cause acid rain. So answer here is A, 1 and 2. So the main chemicals in the air pollution that create acid rain are sulfur dioxide, which leads to the production of sulfuric acid, and nitrogen oxide, which leads to the production of nitric acid. So acid rains occurs usually high in the clouds, where sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, they react with water, oxygen and oxidants, and this mixture forms a mild solution of sulfuric acid, nitric acid, and it can really deteriorate a lot of buildings, human beings, crops, etc. Question number 252, coral formations are found in regions with, so they are found in regions with shallow continental shelf. So answer here is A. So they are found in the regions which have shallow continental shelf, and corals, they need to grow in the shallow water where sunlight can eventually reach them. And statement B, high sediments in the water is incorrect because corals need a lot of clear water that lets the sunlight through, and they don't thrive well when the water is opaque. And the mean annual temperature is not 2 degrees Celsius, it is basically 20 to 32 degrees Celsius. They cannot survive in 2 degrees Celsius, okay? So answer here is A. Question number 253. The process of covering the topsoil with plant material such as leaves, grass, twigs, crop residues, straw, that process is called as mulching, okay? So try to remember this term, mulching. So compost is basically organic matter that has been decomposed and recycled as a fertilizer and soil amendment, and composting requires making a heap of wet organic matter known as green waste, like leaves, wood waste, etc., and waiting for the materials to break down into humus after a period of weeks or months. Now vermicomposting means the use of earthworms for composting organic residues, etc. So that is why they use a lot of earthworms. The farmers, they are called as farmers' friends because of this particular region. So answer here is A, that is mulching. Question number 254. What are the advantages of mulching? It will conserve soil moisture, yes, because you cover it. 75% water is loss is reduced, okay? Basically usage is not required that much. Reduces weed growth, yes. Weed here is kharpatwar, and they are the unnecessary plants which grow. Encourages microbial activity in the soil, that is also correct. So answer here is D, all of the above. All these statements are absolutely correct. So the advantages of mulching includes,
It reduces the water use by up to 75% as it protects the soil from evaporation. It provides valuable nutrients as the mulch breaks down. It also reduces the amount of weeds by inhibiting the germination of weed seeds, and it encourages the worms, which basically aerate the soil and provide fertilizers in the form of worm castings. So answer here is D, all of the above. All these statements are absolutely correct when it comes to mulching. Question number 255. The maximum reproductive capacity of an organism under optimum environmental condition is known as. So this is basically called as the biotic potential. There's a maximum reproductive capacity of an organism. So answer here is A, that is biotic potential. So biotic potential is the maximum reproductive capacity of an organism under optimum environmental conditions. It is often expressed as a proportional or percentage increase per year, and it can also be expressed as the time it takes for a population to double in size. Basically, what we are talking about here is doubling time. So answer here is A, biotic potential. Which of the following are the effects of thermal pollution? It reduces the oxygen holding capacity of the water body. Yes, so this is correct. It enhances the growth of the blue-green algae. This is also correct. It causes deaths of fishes in the aquatic system. This is also correct. So answer here is D, all of the above. So all these statements are correct when it comes to the effects of thermal pollution. So it occurs when the warm water is released into a water body that is 10 degrees Celsius higher than the water body. So consequently, it will reduce the oxygen carrying capacity of the water. It will cause the death and migration of a lot of fish species, and it will even enhance the growth of blue-green algae, which eventually will lead to basically damage to the other species. Question number 257. Paddy field. Paddy is basically rice. It is an important source of which of the following greenhouse gas? So paddy field leads to the production of methane. Okay. So answer here is B. Methane is CH4. So paddy field is a very important source of methane and not carbon monoxide. And oxygen, nitrogen, they are already present in the atmosphere. If they become greenhouse gas, then you are doomed. Okay, then nobody can save you. Question number 258. Which of the following statement is or are correct? Carbon monoxide is a colorless, odorless gas. Yes, absolutely correct. Carbon monoxide is produced as a result of incomplete combustion of carbon. Yes, this is correct. Carbon monoxide can kill you. This is also correct. I'm just kidding. Answer is C, both 1 and 2. Yes, it can kill you. I was not kidding about that part. It can certainly kill you. It is a byproduct of combustion. It is present whenever fuel is burned. And carbon monoxide is basically produced by the incomplete burning of carbon-containing fuel such as coal, oil, charcoal, wood, kerosene, natural gas, propane, etc. And carbon monoxide is found in fumes produced any time when you burn fuels in cars or trucks, small engines, stoves, lanterns, grills, fireplaces, gas ranges, furnaces, etc. And try to avoid using burning wood in your house, especially in place like Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, etc. by having closed windows. Question number 259. Consider the following statements. Overgrazing, mining activities, over-exploitation of groundwater. Which of the following will result in desertification? So basically all of this will lead to the desertification, development of desert-like conditions. So answer here is D, 1, 2, 3. So desertification is the process of sustained land degradation in arid, semi-arid and dry subhumid areas. And it is caused by a lot of human activities like overgrazing, mining activities, unscientific irrigation of the land, over-exploitation of groundwater, etc. Okay. So answer here is D, that is 1, 2, 3. Question number 260, which of the following is also referred to as the tropical rainforest of the oceans? So tropical rainforest of the oceans is something which have like huge productivity value because of the species diversity. Answer here is A, coral reefs. So coral reefs are often, they are called as the tropical rainforest of the sea because they have huge variety, they have huge richness of life, their productivity is also very high. They though have 1% of the ocean floor, they support an estimated 25% of all the known marine species. So thank you for watching this lesson. Hey guys, what's up? So we are discussing environment and ecology MCQs, and we have already covered almost all the MCQs here, but still we'll keep on continuing till we reach 1000 MCQs. And trust me, by the time we are done with this course, we'll be a master in environment and ecology, and it will just it will take you like 10-12 hours to study the entire thing, and you can watch like 3-4 movies or do this. Choice is yours. We'll discuss question number 261 to 270 here. So let's get started. Which of the following sources of energy are considered as renewable? Geothermal energy is obviously renewable. Biofuels are renewable. Biomass is renewable. These are like definitely renewable, but nuclear energy not so much, because uranium is a non-renewable resource. And the answer here is B, 1, 2, 3. So renewable energy is defined as an energy source or fuel type that can basically regenerate and can replenish itself indefinitely. And the five renewable sources used most often includes biomass, wind energy, solar energy, hydro and geothermal. And you might argue that uranium is found in the rocks all over the world. Actually, the nuclear power plants are a very rare type of uranium, that is uranium-235, and it is a non-renewable resource. So answer here is basically B, that is 1, 2, 3. Which of the following is an example for incomplete ecosystem? See, grassland is a complete ecosystem on its own. It does not need anything. Wetland is again a complete ecosystem. Desert is also a complete ecosystem. But cave is not a complete ecosystem. So ecosystem that does not contain all the four basic components, that is the abiotic substances like temperature, air, light, water, etc. Then you have producers, consumers, decomposers. If all of these four, any of these four is missing, and then you are called as basically an incomplete ecosystem. For example, abyssal depth of sea and cave lacks the producers, but it only contains consumers and decomposers. There are no producers as such. Their green plants are absent. So answer here is basically B, cave. It is an incomplete ecosystem. Question number 263. Which of the following results in habitat loss? So mass deforestation will lead to habitat loss for sure. Introduction of invasive species or exotic species, as it is called, it will also lead to the death of the it will lead to the habitat loss because of the competition, and constructor activities in forest areas. So construction will obviously will lead to habitat loss. 1 and 3 are the same almost. Answer is D, 1, 2, 3. So habitat loss can be placed in three categories. One is complete destruction. For example, if you cut down trees and plants, it will instantly change the landscape. And mass deforestation by cutting down trees is a prime example of this. Fragmentation is basically we alter the land in a way that confuses the animals and disrupts their natural way of living. It occurs when we create roads, place attractions in the midst of woodlands and other natural areas. Then you have habitat degradation, when we cause a lot of pollution and we change the quality of air, water and land, and it becomes a breeding ground for toxins. And it also allows these invasive species to come. It will contribute to the downfall of species which is native to the region. All these points are absolutely correct. So answer is D, 1, 2, 3, 4. Consider the following statements. Which of the following are the effects of ozone depletion? Okay. Genetic disorders, yes, of ultraviolet rays, if they are coming, can lead to that. Reduction in chlorophyll content of plants, yes. Failure of rainfall, yes. So answer is basically D, 1, 2, 3. All of this can happen. So depletion of ozone layer will lead to an increase in the ultraviolet radiations which are received by air. So listen to this carefully. If the ozone layer gets depleted, then the ultraviolet radiations received by the earth increase. This will lead to changes in the temperature and rainfall failures. So that is the number one. Then increased harmful radiations, it will lead to reduction in the immunity, increased susceptibility to genetic disorders in plants and animals. And third point is reduction in the growth of plants and reduction in the chlorophyll content. So answer here is technically D, 1, 2, 3. All these statements are absolutely correct. Do you realize now? So if the growth of plants and chlorophyll is affected, change in temperature, rainfall failures, and it can increase harmful radiation, and it can increase our susceptibility to genetic disorders. Question number 265. Lakes tend to be most susceptible to acid rains. Yes. Lake beds have low alkaline content. Yes. Answer is, this is the correct explanation. Both are sahi. Answer is A. So effect of acid rains are most clearly seen in the aquatic or water environment like stream, lakes, marshes. So acid rain flows to streams, lakes and marshes after falling on forest, fields, buildings and roads. And they have low alkaline content in lake beds, and which could neutralize the acid. In contrast, a thick soil covering or soil with a high buffering capacity such as flatland neutralizes the acid rain better. So answer is both are correct. 266. Eutrophication is a process in which we can observe. U means good, trophication means nutrition.
So increase in the nutrients in a water body will be called as eutrophication. So A is wrong. Since A is wrong, D is also wrong. So either B or C is correct. Inhibition of the growth, this is wrong. It promotes the growth of the HABs, harmful algal blooms. And depletion of oxygen from water body is correct. So answer is B. Eutrophication, U means good, trophic means nutrition. It is an enrichment of the water by nutrient salts that causes structural changes to the ecosystem, such as increased production of algae and aquatic plants, depletion of fish species, general deterioration of water quality, and there is an in general increase in the nutrient content of the water body, and consequent to increase in the nutrients, there is an increase in the growth of harmful algal blooms, which even depletes the oxygen. So answer here is B, that is depletion of oxygen. Question number 267, the amount of dissolved oxygen that is used by aerobic microorganisms when decomposing organic matter in water is known as, that is called as the BOD of that particular water. For example, if you increase the dirt or the organic content, the BOD will increase and oxygen will decrease. So BOD, as the BOD is higher, more is the pollution and less it is desirable. So, biological oxygen demand, BOD, is the amount of dissolved oxygen needed by the aerobic biological organisms to break down organic material in a given water sample at certain temperature over a specific time period. Question number 268, assertion, lower level of BOD indicates higher pollution level. Okay, so that statement is false, absolutely false. High level of BOD will indicate higher pollution level. When BOD levels are high, since assertion is false, reason has to be true, you don't need to read it. Dissolved oxygen levels decrease because the oxygen that is available in the water is being consumed by the bacteria, that is correct. So you can read more here, but it is absolutely fine. If BOD increases, pollution increases because it will take more oxygen for the bacteria to get rid of that organic material. Question number 269, which of the following statements about humus is or are true? So humus is highly susceptible to microbial action, this is wrong. Humus undergoes decomposition at a very fast rate, this is also wrong. Answer is D, neither one nor two. So humification is the process of accumulation of a dark colored amorphous substance called as humus. It is very very resistant to microbial action and it undergoes decomposition at an extremely slow rate, and it even serves as a reservoir of nutrients, and it is protected from decomposition by microbial or enzyme action. And then we have the last question for day. Mineralization is the process of degradation of humus to release basically inorganic nutrients. So once mineralization is the decomposition of the chemical compounds in organic matter, which release the nutrients contained in those compounds into soluble inorganic form so that the plants can use it. So thank you for watching this lesson. Guys, what's up? So we are discussing awesome MCQs in environment and ecology, and we'll continue our journey till we reach 1000 MCQs, and we will not stop before that. So don't you worry, I am there with you. So we'll discuss environment and ecology, question number 271 to 280. Okay, so let's get started. Assertion says that ozone can be both good and bad. Yes, this is very true. Ozone in troposphere acts as a shield. Wrong, this is absolutely wrong. Ozone is not there in troposphere. By the way, if it is present, it acts as a poison. It is a very big pollutant. But ozone in stratosphere, since it is way, way above than human beings, there it acts as a shield. So answer here is technically assertion is true and reason is false. So answer here becomes C. So ozone occurs in the two layers of the atmosphere. Usually it is not found in troposphere. So the layer closest to the earth surface is troposphere. Here ground level or the bad ozone is an air pollutant. It is harmful to breathe. It damages crops, trees and other vegetation. And it is a main ingredient of urban smog. On the other hand, the stratosphere or good ozone layer, it extends upwards from about 6 to 30 miles and protects life on earth from the sun's harmful ultraviolet rays. So answer here is assertion is true, but reason is false. Question number 272, which of the following are correctly matched? So methane is paddy fields, this is correct. Lead is from paints, this is correct. Not all paints, but some paints. Sulfur dioxide from thermal power plants, this is correct. All of these are correctly matched. Answer becomes D, 1, 2, 3. So methane is released in permanently flooded soils, which is similar to the paddy fields. And the common sources of lead pollution are manufacturing plants, industries like paint, batteries, bearings, solder, seals, etc. And the common source of sulfur dioxide emission is from burning of sulfur in coal or heavy oil in thermal power plants. So answer here becomes D, that is 1, 2, 3. Question number 273. A sudden increase in the level of acidity of surface waters, that is lakes, streams and rivers in mid-latitude areas is known as. So this is known as acid shock, okay, because of sudden increase in the level of acidity. So a sudden increase in the level of acidity of the surface water, not the entire water, just the surface water of lakes, streams and rivers in the mid-latitude areas caused by the melting in spring of snow, and that has accumulated through the winter and stored the dry fallout of acidic precipitation. Now how does acid shock happens? So acid shock is caused when snow melts and acids that have been gathering in the snow are released into a body of water. Now this sudden change in the water chemistry is known as acid shock, okay? And an acid shock can cause significant damage to freshwater species, habitats, etc. Question number 274, which of the following statement is or are true? Nitrogen and oxygen, they make up almost 98% of the Earth's atmosphere. They do not absorb infrared photons, so this is correct. Carbon dioxide, which is just 0.038%, can absorb and remit infrared energy, and hence it is an effective heat trapping greenhouse gas. Yes, that is why we don't want carbon dioxide to increase. We want to control our fossil fuel burns, etc., etc. So not all the gas molecules are able to absorb infrared radiation. For example, nitrogen, which is 78%, oxygen, which is 21%, which make up roughly 99% of the Earth's atmosphere, they do not absorb infrared photons. And the ability to absorb and re-emit infrared energy is what makes CO2 a greenhouse gas, which is an effective heat trapping greenhouse gas. And CO2 molecules can vibrate in ways that simpler nitrogen and oxygen molecules cannot. And it allows CO2 molecules to capture the IR photons. Important point. So nitrogen oxides released in air will react with water, oxygen and other chemicals to form the acid rain. Yes, this is correct. Fertilizers like ammonia is produced by reacting nitrogen from the air with the hydrogen at high pressure and temperature in the presence of a catalyst. So answer here basically becomes C, that is both 1 and 2. Both these statements are correct. So acid rain is caused by emissions of sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxide. They react with the water molecules in the atmosphere to produce the acids. Ammonia is manufactured by combining nitrogen and hydrogen in an important industrial process, which is called as the Haber's process. And Haber's process basically combines nitrogen from the air with the hydrogen derived mainly from the natural gas or the methane into ammonia. So Haber's process is responsible for production of ammonia. Question number 276, which of the following statements about humus is or are true? It helps to retain water in the soil. Yes, this is 100% correct because it also prevents the evaporation. It improves the buffering capacity, that is neutralizes pH in the soil. Yes, it reduces leaching. Yes. So answer is, it does all these 3 points. Answer is D, 1, 2, 3. So advantages of the humus includes, it increases soil fertility and soil digestion. So this is the first point. It suppresses the weed growth. This is second point. It improves the buffering capacity. That is, it neutralizes pH in the soil. Fourth is, it neutralizes the harmful compounds. Then it converts and stores excess nutrients in a plant-friendly manner. Then it reduces leaching and infiltration of water is improved. So answer here basically becomes, these are all the advantages of humus. Try to remember it as much as possible. Question number 277. Which of the following are considered as biopesticides? So canola oil, baking soda, bacillus thuringiensis, because it is used in BT cotton, BT brinjal, etc. So this is definitely a biopesticide. Answer is D, all of the above. So biopesticides are types of pesticides derived from such natural materials like plants, animals, bacteria and certain minerals. So for example, canola oil will repel insects by altering the outer layer of the leaf surface or by acting as an insect irritant. Okay. So baking soda, also called as sodium bicarbonate, is a cheap and effective way to protect the plants against mildew and cabbage worm. And Bacillus thuringiensis BT with Cry1AC gene, it produces a toxin, BT toxin, which will kill the beetles because it becomes alkaline in their stomach and get activated. So they are toxic to immature insects, larvae, etc. Question number 278, which of the following are the advantages of using biopesticides? Protects water quality, this is correct. Host specificity, that is correct. no toxic residue. This is also correct. So answer is D, 1, 2, 3. All these statements are correct. So advantages of biopesticides basically includes host specificity. It is very, very host specific. No problem of toxic residue, no evidence or absence of resistance, permanent control of pest, and no environmental pollution. Question number 279, which what is the effect of heavy dust in atmosphere on plants? So basically it leads to closure of stomata. So stomata are plugged by particulate matter, and leaf blight is a fungal disease that will thrive in such warm temperature. And browning of leaves occurs when a plant isn't able to absorb enough water to compensate for hot dry weather, which causes quick evaporation of water from the soil. Question number 280. Cytosilicosis is a form of occupational lung disease causing inhalation of crystalline silica dust. Where it is common? Crystalline silica dust you will find in cement industry. So answer here is A. So there are different types of silicosis. So just read it about here. Thank you.